Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Mitch Medigovich, and I wanted to welcome you to our 911 Advisory Board meeting. We're getting us a little bit later start because there was some unforecasted traffic that was reported in, and so we wanted to make sure we gave everybody ample time to get to this meeting. I appreciate you coming out here to the California Room. We haven't done a meeting over here for this part of the Cal OES campus. So what I'd like to do is start by letting you know that restrooms are, if you go back out in the hallway, they're kind of shielded behind one of the walls there. It's kind of in the middle between the rooms, so you will find them if you, they're actually are easily accessible. You just have to kind of wander and go behind the wall there, and you'll see them there. And of course, if there's an emergency, we're going to exit out probably either this door or the other door right here on the main side. We'll just clear the building and wait till we get it all clear and take care of business. So thank you. So without further ado, Paul, if you'd please take the roll.
Mitch Medvedich?
Present.
Chief Scott Howland?
Present.
Charles Perdan?
Present.
Assistant Chief David Wilson?
Here.
Chief Michael Langston? Sheriff Corey Honia? Sheriff James Maley? Chris Heron.
Here.
Chief Michael Miller.
Here.
Charles Cullen.
Present.
Paul Truxell.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Excellent. Our first item of business is the approval of our previous meeting minutes. Is there any discussion or, and if there are no discussion items, then we'll be looking for a motion to approve the minutes.
Chris Heron, I'll make a motion to approve.
Charles Berdan, second.
Okay, we have a motion, and at this point in time, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Next agenda item is the closed session, so we'll be moving into closed session at this point, and we'll be covering outages, and then we'll be reconvening as soon as we finish here. So for those of you in the audience, we'll be back here shortly. So thank you. Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate your patience for everyone there. The meeting is reconvened here out of closed session. And joining us in closed session, due to some of the accidents that we had there, was Sheriff Honia. I wanted to, Corey, welcome you to the board and to the audience, make sure that you're officially noted in the minutes as present for the meeting. So, this time I'd like to introduce Mr. Reggie Salvador, who's going to climb up and give a legislative update for the office here. Thank you.
Hello, folks. So I'm just a couple of brief items. Earlier in August, I think it was on August 3rd, there was a hearing on Next Generation 911, which many of you had participated in and testified in, regarding the path forward on both implementing and funding Next Generation 911. Prior to that, in July, the governor signed AB 1769, I believe, which was from Assemblymember Rodriguez, that would essentially add the prank calling 911 through a cell phone as a crime. Also, 2 days ago, the governor signed AB 1564 from Assemblymember Doss Williams that essentially has OES work to maximize the efficiency of the 911 system by both working with county coordinators and CHP on assessing call routing for 911, and then ensuring that if there are recommended reroutes, that the telecoms actually implement those reroutes. So that's essentially it. Any questions?
Reggie, does that bill require an annual review of all the cell sites?
No, it conducts a continual review.
Okay.
Hey, thank you, Reggie. Appreciate your time and appreciate the update.
Thanks.
And our next agenda item is item five. It's Ms. Elisa Kim, who is the Executive Director for 911 for Kids and who's going to discuss with us the program and their public outreach.
Good morning, everyone. Some of you are familiar with 911 for Kids. Some of you are not. So I thought it would be fitting to put together a really simple packet for you all. And I won't go through the details of it, but I think most important that you know that 911 for Kids is not just for kids. It serves adults and seniors and really all citizens of all ages. And it was created actually beginning in 1990 by an ad hoc committee made up of the California State 911 Office, APCO, NENA, and a variety of 911 vendors. And the main purpose of this group was to create a really effective education program that had carried the three key message points, when and when not to call 911, how to dial 911, and what to say to the dispatcher, and that the program was easy to use and had a long shelf life. So the collaborative effort came up with the first phase, and you can I included a few of the visuals in the very back of some of our teaching packets here, which are all endorsed by the Department of Education, which I included a letter from that group on page 3. But most importantly, to just condense this, is that the mission of this program is to reduce 911 misuse through public education. And in the end, is those are the individuals who are calling the, causing the misuse are the callers and consumers. So we already know, and I don't want to preach to the choir, that over 50% of calls made to PSAPs are not emergencies. And I remember Charlie Cullen telling me, "Is first thing you have to say is 911 is not for education, I mean not for information." And a simple point, but a point not always noted, and I think that's an ongoing message that the general public and consumers need to always be aware of. And so that means that in California alone, over 12 million calls are made for non-emergency purposes, impacting the 460-plus PSAPs in California. And I believe at the national level, it's close to 250 million now. And in brief, is the cost of that is not just financial, but there's a loss of confidence with our 911 centers, its leadership, staff, consultants, and vendors. There's naturally the financial loss, potential initiation of legal action and lawsuits because of negligence on behalf of the 911 center for not correctly educating the public. Most obvious areas is loss of lives and possible permanent medical impairment, loss and damage to properties, and then also crimes that might have been halted that are perpetrated. So how can we reach the entire state? Well, since 1996 when we launched, our whole goal was to create a caller consumer program in each of the 58 counties. And working with the state 911 office, they've been wonderful in helping to provide that product, the educational products, to the 911 centers. But still, as we mainly have a volunteer operation with our group, and we're a foundation. So we really need the support in a more strategic plan, and I know I was talking to you, Paul, is how can we really educate and empower all 58 counties so that they can strategically have an ongoing program. And I know that the state office has created a really wonderful interactive website, and I think that we need to continue with developing tools, which brings into some of the new things that we're trying to do is to create tools that the individual PSAPs can use with ease electronically, bringing in our athletes and entertainers from our organization, which you can see the three main leaders, Tim Brown being the main leader, Kathy Ireland, and then Howie Long. And we are not embarrassed or afraid to ask other California-based athletes and entertainers to please help with this cause. So I think with that, if you have any questions, you can go through this packet. And I don't know, Paul or Charlie, did you want to add something?
Yes, absolutely, Elisa. It's a great program, and I actually serve on the board of 911 for Kids. And I think that a couple of things that you didn't mention that 911 for Kids does that are very that is very beneficial for the PSAP community and the community at large is your recognition program for dispatchers and kids and others who have had extraordinary incidents where they have either saved a life or gotten the response there, and recognizing the dispatchers, as we all know, dispatchers are don't get a lot of recognition, and they are the first of the first responders. So I think that that's one of the really good things that 911 for Kids does. Another thing I would like to point out is the education program that 911 for Kids does is a great opportunity to get out into the community and talk about the positive things that your department does. And staffing is an issue for all PSAPs, but staffing permitting, we send a dispatcher out and usually with a police officer and a vehicle and talk about not only 911 but the department as a whole. So it's a great way to get out there in the community and talk about what your department does and the positive things that that law enforcement and fire does. So fire's America heroes, so they don't need all the they don't need the outreach like we do, but it is a really great program. And I think that if you can do it, and part of it is getting it up and running, 911 for Kids provides all the educational material. It's about an hour. You talk to kids kinder, K through 5 and really talk to them about 911 and what the service is for. And I think with the onset of text to 911 and next generation 911, it's going to be a great opportunity for 911 for Kids to expand that program and talk about how the technology is changing and what where 911 is going in the future. So thank you for all your efforts, Elise. Appreciate it.
I'd like to echo what Charlie said. The recognition provided is just wonderful. This last weekend, we were able to honor two local heroes here out of Folsom with two young heroes. I think it was 8 or 9 years old and about 12 years old. The impact that made on those lives, I think they're going to hold those medals and truly understand what 911 means from this day forward. And that's how we build advocates in our community, is by reaching out and recognizing the continued education, recognizing when people do a great job. I think the way social media is now, one of the things that I would like to do is work with 911 for Kids in getting some social media pieces that we can take to our local jurisdiction. Whatever social media that we have, be it Facebook, Instagram, put it out there, share with our community. We make it portable, it's very easy. We work with our community leaders. Our community leaders then become a satellite of us and just continue to carry that message. And, I'm committed to work with Elise and the team and Charlie to really support this. And I again, thank you and what you guys do to help support us.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Charlie. I think the other thing that's very important for this council to recognize is that 911 consumer public education is not an elective. I mean, everyone looks at our our products and all the wonderful things in the media. But it needs to be a strategic component of 911 operations, because 911 is for the general public, the consumers. They're the ones who are impacting and causing the problems with misuse. So public education is really critical. And beginning in 1968, when 911 started in the United States, you know, there was tremendous focus on the equipment, technology, the operations, the staffing. But, you know, with the stress and the pressure and the focus on just the operational portion of getting a center up, they did not really focus on the consumer. And that's why now California is truly the leader in our nation. And we need to show that we can do this in a comprehensive way with one of the greatest states in the nation, or the greatest state, and show other states how we can do it and do it effectively, economically, and efficiently. 911 for Kids is in all 50 states, Canada and Cayman Islands, and we're based here. We were started by California leaders, and we want to get a model going so that we can roll it out to other states, so that's really important. In closing, I want to thank Bill. Thank you so much for your support. You have a wonderful team. And then if Michelle Bland is here, she's with CHP. She has been incredible in leading the way in working through the California CHP divisions in getting the program initiated. So thank you all very much. I also have some sample packets. Did everyone get one of these? Did they all get? Okay. So I'll give you those and you can hand those out too.
Elise, could I ask you to repeat that stat of number of calls that are misuse?
Okay. I believe, according when I spoke to Commissioner Farrow, he said that there were 24 million calls made to California annually. I believe that was several years ago. And so 12 million, 50%, are misuse or non-emergency. And then if you go nationally, CTIA Wireless and NENA have stated that there are over 240 million calls made to over 6,000 911 centers in the United States. And well over 50%, sometimes up to 70%, are non-emergency calls. So it's significant. So that's why I was saying it's confidence in the program, financially, which everyone's concerned about. So you can imagine. And then as anyone who's familiar with the way PSAPs operate is when those, you know, so many lines, so many rollover queues. So when those are filled up, it's busy and someone with a real emergency is stuck. And that's where you have the potential legal problems.
Yeah, and I wanted you to repeat that because that number is just so staggering. And I think it's a good reminder for us just to really keep in perspective that that education component is so important with our folks, because as you said, for every misuse call, that means someone who has a real emergency is going to be delayed. And whether that's a busy signal or it's just a few seconds, those few seconds count in an emergency. And I think it's a good reminder that that education component is an ongoing thing. It's not a one and done, but something that we have to continually work on. And so on behalf of, you know, the CHP and the board, I want to thank you for your portion and your organization's work in that outreach, because it's very, very important. And I think we all struggle with routing and we struggle with staffing and everything else. But when you look at the numbers, if we could make 50% of our calls go away, that is an amazing impact on our system and how well our system can work. And so thank you for the work that you guys are doing. Keep it up, because it seems like we have a lot of work still to do.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Kim. So thank you. Once again, thank you, Ms. Kim. We're proud to partner with you and appreciate all of your leadership. So with that, we'll move on to our next agenda item, which is in your packet, and I know some of the folks have that were available in the rear there, is a Department of Transportation Highway Administration request for information. And Bill, I don't know if you're going to be coming up to discuss part of that, but we have the in your packet, you'll see that there's a request for information that has come from Department of Transportation, and the suspense date is the 20th of September. And on the, it's just a two-page item from the Federal Register. It's in your packet. And on the second page in the back, you'll actually see the list of questions that are there. There are basically 15 questions that they're looking for input from us on. And I wanted to make sure we had a chance to open it up for discussion here at the board meeting and take your comments at this time.
Okay, I had the opportunity to talk to Lori Flaherty, who's the head of National 911. And my question to her was, what was predicated the request for the RFI and the information? And National 911 and the FCC had an opportunity to talk, and they realized there's a vast amount of information across the United States. Is this on? Yes. Across the United States within the PSAP community that isn't tapped right now. And it could be used to support the development of PSAPs, looking at call stats where we can evaluate 911 across the United States. So that predicated this. And part of the problem is the information is there, but it's not formatted or it's not in a way to make use of. So they're looking for a way in getting information from the PSAP community to get this information into a national level, into a consistent standard, where we can take this information and draw and glean additional information from what is provided to us, so we can look at bettering 911 across the United States, not only at the PSAP level, but at a regional level, a state level, and at a national level. So that was what predicated the whole context of the report. There's about 15 questions that they're asking in the RFI of various questions that pertain to information that the PSAP or public safety community would like to see in a database. And so that is the gist of the whole RFI right now, is to get public safety community to respond to this, to provide them the information, to be able to consolidate all of this information in a usable database that it would be accessible across the country to allow people at all levels to improve 911.
Bill, is this something that's going to go out to all the PSAPs in California to reply to, or is it going to go through
the state? Well, it's out there already. Everybody has access to the report.
Okay.
Yeah. And if you look at, you should have this in your packet. On page two is the list of the questions that are asked. And some are specific to, information that's contained in the CAD record and stuff like that. So it varies.
On that note, Bill, could the state 911 office send out a notice to the PSAP distribution group?
Yeah, we can. Yeah.
I think it would be a good idea.
Yeah, we can do that. Advise them that the RFI is out there and they should respond to it. The final filing date is the end of September, so there's still time.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, well, thank you, Bill. I appreciate that. We'll make sure that we get that out and also work to a response from the 911 branch as well as part of the request for information that has come from. Okay, the next agenda item is titled Optimal Public Safety Answering Point Architecture. The intent is for us to discuss the final report that was provided by, and you can see it there, it's called TFOPA, and there's some certain working group reports that are provided, and have a chance to get some feedback from all of you or entertain any questions or things that we need to do follow-up information on.
Yeah, I think this probably feeds back into what the long-range planning committee and work groups have been looking at as potential solutions to California's transition into next gen 911, and also the director's desire to move into regionalized type of call taking. Obviously, as Mitch said, the task force on optimal PSAP architecture is by the FCC. There's actually three working groups. Work group one focused on cybersecurity, work group two focused on architecture, and work group three focused on funding. So this is basically looking at various ways that you can configure or design 911 as we moved into a next-gen environment. I think if you go right to the back of the report, and that's kind of the gist of it, it's really, there is no one solution to next-gen 911. And we've all had this discussion in many cases. It's something you really have to evaluate the state or the 911 system you're working with and determine what is the best solution. And in California, that could materialize in many different forms. What we do in one portion of California may not fit another portion of California. I mean, we're very disparate, and when we look at our population and how it's dispersed across California, one area we may want to have one system focusing on just maybe LA, but yet we take into account multiple counties in another area, and we look at completely different in how we consider the architecture for next-gen 911. So I'm going to let Charlie or Chris kind of chime in right now because they've been working with the LRPC and work groups in this, and they can kind of bring us up on speed on that portion of it.
Thanks, Bill. Yes, I think that the LRPC did take a look at this report, and I'll be referencing it later through Chuck's working group when we talk a little bit about consolidation and regionalization. And as you mentioned, I mean, California is the size of a medium-sized country with very diverse demographics. Our geography is varied from very small, very low population, large geographic areas to dense urban areas. So one size fits all. It certainly doesn't apply in California, and I think that it is a complex issue. How do you consolidate and still provide the level of service that the public expects? And we'll talk a little bit more about that. Chuck and the working group have a good start on identifying the issues and potential models for consolidation, and we get to that portion of the meeting. Yeah. Chris, anything to add?
I think the intent of me asking that this be shared was just so that we made sure that the board members and the PSAP community in California was aware of the report. And as you've both said, the LRPC and the work group are working on this issue. So yeah. Nothing more.
Yeah, and this is also being addressed, too, with the transition plan that Kimball is doing for us right now. So the suggestions that they come up with, the recommendations, you know, will be looked at and weighed against the report.
For the new members that may not have been aware, so that we have commissioned and worked to have LR Kimball come out and help develop a transition plan for presentation to us and to help guide us in where we should be going for next generation 911 and how that will be established for us. It's going to give us a footprint and kind of hopefully a roadmap to address some of the complexities that are listed in here in this report, and also give us some solid recommendations to move forward on. Well, thank you. If there's no other questions from the board on the report or from it, we'll move on to our next item. And if you have difficulty gaining access, all these reports are still on our website, correct, RL3? Do you know, Paul?
All these reports will be posted on our website after the conclusion of this advisory board meeting.
Okay, excellent. So, and then Ms. Wong, who represented our office, Karen Wong, she was one of the members on one of the task force subgroups. She did help participate in it and try to bring California's voice into the process on it as well. So with that, we'll move into the next agenda item, which is expanding new public safety answering points. Bill.
Yeah, this comes about as we have received requests from various public safety entities to be recognized and receive state funding to become a public safety answering point. One of the most recent ones was brought to the board earlier this year by the city of Tehachapi. We did an analysis that presented the information to the board, and basically they did not meet the minimum call volume, published call volume of 300 calls per month. At that time, they brought their case to the board, and the board recognized that they did not meet the state standards and denied their request to be PSAP. We have a couple other that are still in limbo, so to speak. That is with the city of Truckee and city of Brentwood. Thank you. Both of these cities put in requests in June for Truckee and August 24th of 2015 for Brentwood. Both of them meet the call standards of 300 calls per month. And in both cases, if they were granted PSAP status, they will not impact the agencies that currently take calls for them. Brentwood's calls are currently taken by the city of Antioch. And if we were to allow Brentwood to become a PSAP, they would have a call volume of approximately 1,000 calls per month. Antioch would still have a call volume of over 4,000 calls per month. So there would not be a big loss to Antioch there, just maybe reduction in one call-taking position over time, which would end up in the Brentwood PSAP. The same goes true for Truckee. They are currently have their calls answered by Nevada County Sheriff. And should Truckee become a PSAP, they would have a call volume approximately 400 calls per month on average. And Nevada County Sheriff would still see calls in the range of 2,000 calls per month. So in both cases, there's not a major impact to the existing PSAP. Cost-wise, these are both two- and three-position PSAPs. Truckee would be a two-position due to call volume, and Antioch would be a three. Looking at the five-year cost, you're looking about $232,000 for Truckee over 5 years, and $285,000 for Brentwood. Averaging out, it's $3,878 per month. We would tax the Setna Fund more right now if we were to grant Truckee's request, and $4,700 more per month for Brentwood. Either case, it's not a significant amount of money at this point in time. We've all talked, we know where the Setna is at right now, and obviously we don't want to tax the Setna any more than we have to, but being that these both these public safety agencies had made requests, they do meet the requirements, we're looking to the board to make a recommendation should we go ahead and grant PSAP status to them. With that being said, should that occur, we need to look forward more beyond this, that we do still have a declining Setna fund that we need to protect. And we want to make sure that we either at this point in time look at ways to maybe limit the expansion of PSAPs at this point. Some of the suggestions we have talked about is grant this request at this point in time, and then suspend all future PSAP requests until the Setna fund has been corrected. As Reggie mentioned, we had the hearing, and it's been brought to the legislature's attention, so we, you know, we hope that that will drive legislation to get the Setna fund corrected. But so I wanted to open this up to the board and get some feedback from everyone.
I'll start.
Whoever wants to be first.
Well, actually, I think the LRPC has plans to make a recommendation to change the threshold in the operations manual. Charlie, I don't know if you agree or not, but I think we might want to have that discussion first or at this point, because it would directly impact this decision, right? Or potentially could.
Well, I don't know if are we moving the goalposts on communities that have applied under the existing rules. I'm not sure that's really a fair way to do it, in my opinion, although there is a larger issue of the Setna Fund, and we certainly had discussion yesterday they're going to bring forward to the full board today about moving the threshold to a much higher level. So I'm more inclined to look at these independently, and I think that Bill's suggestion of, you know, if they're applying under the rules, they meet the rules as they are, perhaps these are the last two that we grant and suspend it until we come to a new decision on a new threshold, and B, a new funding model that's going to sustain Cetna.
And so I'll speak to that then, because I certainly support the change in the threshold that we'll recommend later today, but I wouldn't support suspending all new PSAPs unless there's a realistic end goal. And I think right now we would be saying, well, we're going to suspend it until something happens. But we really don't, I don't know of the plan that is, you know, going to get us there within the next legislative session or the one after that. So I couldn't support suspending all new PSAP applications.
Okay, because I think one of the things we have to look at, Chris, too, as we're hoping to see or planning to see the transition plan come to fruition in early 2017. That is going to address the direction that California is going to be recommended to go in as far as a next generation 911. It's also going to be able to address the concept of regionalization or consolidation, however you want to speak to it. So I think with that, and as Charlie says, we have an idea of what we want to set as a call standard for PSAP to meet. And also this will work with the Cetna saying, okay, if we know we have to get the Cetna corrected, so we don't want to tax it too heavily and continue to tax that. But if the intent of California is to move into regionalization, then we need to take that into account as do we really want to increase the number of PSAPs, or we need to start looking at is how do we want to start consolidating those or bringing them together into regional operational centers, if that is the direction.
Would a suspension still provide for the normal appeals process, or?
That's a good question.
Okay. I could perhaps support a suspension that's still allowed for an appeals process mm-hmm. to come before the board in case there's a extenuating circumstance that comes along.
The Warren Act allows for an appeal. So this does not change the Warren Act, so that is still in effect. If we did put a suspension, they could still, I assume, always request an appeal through the board.
For either of these PSAPs, if they're granted the ability to expand, are they in a position to be able to share resources with one of their other jurisdictional agencies? Regional consolidation, not physical consolidation?
With technology, that's very easy to accomplish. Mm-hmm. I mean, we do that right now with hosted solutions, consolidation of backroom equipment into two geographic dispersed areas, and we just hang, essentially, monitors and equipment off there. So that can be done at pretty much any time we need to. Yeah, so this could always be augmented down the road to bring them into fold with a more regionalized system.
Right. Is that their proposal? Is that something they've looked at? And I think of Truckee, I'm just wondering, is there enough network capacity around Truckee to support that, or would that be maybe an additional cost? I guess that's my question.
That I wouldn't know. We had the opportunity to speak to Truckee back at APCO a couple of weeks ago, and I don't know.
Is Truckee represented today?
No. We anticipated having a representative from Truckee here. But in listening to their concerns, we understand why they want to become a PSAP. They are kind of isolated in that area. Nevada County Sheriff has moved over into the Grass Valley area, and there's potential, I guess, for CHP to possibly dispatch out of another area. So they're looking at they might be the only game in town, so they want to take. So they're looking to take the calls themselves in that particular area. And that's about as limited as I can say what they told me, because I can't remember everything.
Okay, thank you.
Bill, on the that somewhat explains the Truckee's need for a separate PSAP. How about Brentwood? Have they given you an explanation of why they want to split from Antioch?
I believe Brentwood's is they believe they can take the calls better. They're having problems with response from Antioch, and so they like to take the calls themselves.
Thank you. Well, I think if I can kind of give my opinion about whether or not we have a suspension or moratorium, I think Charlie's right. I think it's not fair to change the rules in the middle of the game for existing requests. But I also think that we do have to look forward to what is going to happen to the Setna. We don't have today, we don't have a solution. We have no guarantee of a solution in the next legislative session. And I don't know if the 911 branch has thought about what's going to happen when expenses exceed funds, income.
Yes, we have.
Okay.
We have sat down and looked at the areas where obviously we can cut expenses immediately. The problem is the majority of expenses with the Setna are made up out of three primary areas. That's database cost, network, and CPE. I mean, there's a lot of costs we have as far as training, public outreach, and things like that that we could cut, but that's 10% of the existing budget, and that's not going to correct the Setna by any way, shape, or form. You'd have to make a much bigger access to that. So if we were really looking at starting to have to make cuts, we would probably have to look at areas within the CPE area as far as extending replacements and things like those. And these are things we've tossed around. It's not in stone, but obviously that is the first area we could make adjustments to in saving money. We can't suspend network, we can't suspend database. So those are kind of fixed. So that's the area we would look at potential savings.
So I would envision that as PSAPs come up for renewals and upgrades, that you know there's a possibility that they may be asked to defer, you know, for some period of time because there isn't sufficient funds. You're not going to go into the red in the Setna fund.
Right. Yeah, that's been considered. Yes.
Well, I would have to say then that, you know, I think, like I said, I don't want to change the game on anybody who's in the middle of it. So I think the number of, or the requirements today are, should be, you know, considered at the 300 level. But I also think that we have to consider not only the funding aspects of it, but the fact that you know, it's been stated publicly by Director Ghilarducci that we may have too many PSAPs already. And I think looking down the road at 5-10 years, we are looking at a, you know, a definite move or a definite intention to move to fewer PSAPs. And are we just compounding the problem by, you know, granting more as we, you know, as we go through this transitional period? So I'm very torn between the two. And I think they need to be looked at. My personal recommendation, Truckee definitely has a viable need if they're going to be the only PSAP in the basin on that side of the lake. It's definitely a priority. But agencies that want to split up because they're not happy with, you know, who's doing their or how their business is being done, I tend to want make them find solutions instead of separating.
Sure, I have a couple of questions. Bill, does the 911 office make the decision to allow a PSAP to open, and if they deny it, the appeal comes to this board for approval, or does the board approve all new PSAPs?
No, we approve whether a PSAP.
And the appeal
based
would
on
come
requirements
here
within the operations manual.
And yeah, if you deny it, they have an appeal to this board.
Correct. Yeah, okay. Through the Warren Act, they are allowed to appeal to the board.
And then I agree about the idea of not changing the game, but if that's the case, it's going to take months to change the game, so to speak, and then anyone that's even thinking about it, if they were smart and paying attention, they would be coming here requesting it, and then it would be approved if they met the threshold. And so as I don't like, you know, the manual should be clear, I think we're almost at a crisis with funding that until something changes, we should recommend that the office make some changes to the manual sooner than later, because I think we'll run into a problem towards the end of the year when you have 5, 6, 7, 8 lots of requests coming in. That's one thing. And then the other thing, as we prepare to advocate for changing the way we collect, the state collects money, I think it might be helpful to get a better idea of where the state 911's office money is spent, and new PSAPs equipment programs. I believe that Cal Fire's CAD system is still funded by that fund.
That's correct.
So I think it would be helpful if we're going to advocate and recommend to our various boards that we represent. I think it would be helpful to have some kind of overview on the budget that would help us move forward, or at least get a better understanding of.
Yeah, if
we can do that. That's a good piece, Dave. We'll make sure that we set that up into the next agenda so that you have a chance to go through, and we can walk through all of the budgetary pieces to it, or share it with you before, between the meetings. So.
Yeah, we track very closely where the expenses go through the SETNA that our office pays for, so we can make a presentation on, so you can see how the money is spent across during the year. Thing I would like to follow up, and I know we're going to be having a discussion on minimum call volume later on this afternoon to become a PSAP. If that's one of the things the board all agrees on, we can institute that immediately and put that into the operations manual.
And that's what the LRPC is going to propose today, is that it's really a choice between two numbers on the threshold. We can talk about that a little later, or we can talk about it now. But we do have a proposal to change that threshold and raise it considerably. So, yeah.
How many, when we talk about 400 calls, what does that translate to for workload for somebody who's actually taking calls, if that's their volume?
That's about 10 calls a day, 11 calls a day. It's less than half a call per hour on an average through 24-hour day. It's very, 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 very small.
Thank you. I think, and I really appreciate the board commenting, because we can see what we're looking at, and this doesn't address the need for the, which was talked a little bit earlier on, as we approach our setting a change to implement next generation 911. And the other portion, you know, this discussion is okay, so we have folks that are on the minimum threshold, or that it may be below the new proposed standards that are there, and what does that mean for us in the future, and future funding to customer premise equipment for those sites that are have a very low call up volume, and are we going to continue, and how are we going to address that, and or are we going to work with them individually to help, you know, develop solutions and see what's available for them. But, you know, it's you know, it is definitely the hard part, and if we were not in a resource constrained environment, we could do everything, but we know that we have to make some tough decisions here as they go forward.
Yeah, and we have discussed that, Mitch, and call volume alone, I think we just can't make a decision based on call volume. We really have to look at the impact to the areas being served by that PSAP, because we do have some very small PSAPs that have low call volumes, but if you were to pull that PSAP out of that particular area, you could impact the ability to deliver 911 services to the community. So those are all things that have to be evaluated along with everything else. So it can't strictly be a fiscal decision.
So one additional comment, and I hear and respect the opinions that my colleagues have put forth, but Bill, you caught me when you said that there's been some discussions about potentially deferring CP upgrade. So when the work group a couple of years ago discussed funding and recommended the funding policies that have been adopted, one of the things we did is we essentially mandated that PSAPs perform their upgrades within that 5 to 7 year window.
Correct.
So I would caution the 911 office that looking at pushing that out or potentially deferring upgrade or maintenance would not be a good idea. And what I would say to my colleagues is, if that is a serious consideration that the 911 office is thinking about, then why would we add PSAPs to the mix? So anyway, I'll leave it at that, but
yeah.
It just, those do not seem to go together well. Now,
yeah,
if that's just one of the many, many ideas that's being floated, and it's not, you know, really under serious consideration, okay,
yeah,
but we shouldn't add PSAPs to the mix if we're talking about in the very near future telling other PSAPs that we're not going to fund you when we look at the outage report and see that CP equipment is one of the things that causes outages, right, we don't want to defer that.
Yeah, yeah.
No, it's a good point. And I didn't hear him say it quite that way. What I heard him say was that he had fixed cost that he really couldn't negotiate around. And then the CP, which is what it is, what you're saying, was that the CP was one of the few items that he had some flexibility in. So he couldn't adjust network and data that he could adjust. That's one of the few areas that we had a discretionary movement in.
Yeah, and we do. We sit down, because we do look at the worst case scenario and talk about what would we do if we get to this critical point. We're hoping we don't get to that critical point, that things get corrected. But those are obviously things we sit down and sit around the table, what are areas? I mean, that obviously is a potential. It doesn't mean it's going to something that's going to come to fruition. But, you know, since the question was asked by Charlie, that what would we do? That's potential.
I appreciate that, and I just think there are many things that can come before that. You know, the 10%
yes,
that you talked
yeah.
about, in training and the ATA, perhaps residual
mm-hmm.
Expenses.
Yeah,
I mean,
and those
I
would
think
be the
all
first
of those
things
would
yeah.
should come first.
Yeah,
right?
Those are the first things that we would look at, and it would be a gradual move into reducing funding back to see how far it goes. And a lot of it is going to be based on a sense of when we may get legislation in place to correct that. I mean, because once we get the legislation in place, if it goes correctly, we'll be able to adjust the fund yearly to account for whatever expenses we need to. And that's really where we want to get to, hopefully. But as we get closer to that point, then we can start looking at potential plans to adjust funding and to make sure we don't go into the red with the Setna.
And it sounds like we're in the perfect storm from the standpoint of we're at a point with the Setna fund that we're looking at being in the red soon, and once that gets corrected, that fixes the problem so that we then don't have to defer CPV or other stuff. And it almost seems like these are coming at the time where we do have the perfect storm. We have the challenge on the fund. We have the discussions about regionalization, although we don't have a plan as far as how that's going to work yet. We have, you know, recommendations pending as far as changing our threshold. You know, it seems like it's just everything's all colliding all at the same mm-hmm. part and making it a tough decision for the office.
Right.
And I'm not sure we should be making our decision based on the funding or lack thereof. I mean, it's not this body's job to go out and get the funding. That's the legislature's job. Mm-hmm. So if we base every decision on the idea that we're going to go into the red, eventually nobody's going to be funded. So I think we have to look at it objectively and what's best for the PSAP and the state as a whole. So
well, I appreciate the discussion on that, Bill. Did we answer what you're looking for at this point?
I got a definite maybe.
I mean, I think if you're looking for a recommendation, we'd like a little more detail in terms of what each PSAP, why they feel that they need to be an independent PSAP. And it sounds like Truckee's pretty well articulated, but certainly from Brentwood's perspective, are they seeing a delay in calls being processed and getting the information? I mean, what is the driver behind their request is really what I think we'd like to see.
We can go back and request that they reiterate their reason for becoming a PSAP.
Any other comments from the board? Okay, well, thank you. I appreciate the good discussion on it, and no easy answers, but we'll continue to work it, and we'll tackle it, and we'll continue to collaborate with our partners, both at the local level and the legislature, and come find a way to meet some solutions. Next item, which should also be a spirited little discussion here for us, is call times and answering times for our public safety answering points. So we asked Mr. Anderson to take a little time to talk about call answer times. We had some outreach from due to some call answer time problems from some of the communities, which led to requests for information from the media, which we provided to them and that they responded to, which we decided that we should have this discussion here. Those times are posted. We were not, they're being fully transparent on which answering points are meeting the thresholds or what kind of actions they have. But we thought it would be a good opportunity to let you know what, and have an opportunity to discuss answer times for the community, what our current standard is, where we're proposing to go for it, and our continued encouragement to those answering points that are not meeting that threshold to try to do better. So a lot of reasons there, and I think not all times does the public know that it's a chain of events that takes place, and the call is one sequence of it, where you know the readiness of the vehicles and everything else that comes behind it, and whether it's translation services, and there's going to be a lot of complexities. It's not simply did I pick up the call right away, it, you know, that quickly. And there may be a lot of other mitigating factors that go into it. That said, our focus is on answering, and how do we fix just that one segment of it, and what should we be doing about it? So, but that, I'll turn it over to Bill.
Yeah, obviously in the past few months, call answer times have become very prominent in the public. A couple incidents that happened in San Diego brought it to the press. They responded to our office asking for information, as Mitch said, and I did a couple interviews with reporters on that. But it does bring into question, just like everything else we talk about, is what is the appropriate amount of time for a PSAP to answer calls. Right now, there's a number of standards out there. There's not one constant standard, and we found that to be true, especially after we went to APCO. But it the way it is currently written is the PSAP does not respond or does not answer calls within California's posted call answer times, they're subject to funding restrictions. Now, whether or not that's the best way to address this or not is subject to discussion. That's where we're bringing this to the board today. And then when you look in the Warren Act, it says if a PSAP does not meet the criteria set forth by our office, they're subject to potential discipline by the Attorney General. So there's a couple different things we have to look at. What we are finding is there's a lot of disparity about what a call answer time should be. California currently has published that all calls, meaning 100% of the calls, have to be answered within 10 seconds for the busiest hour of a shift. That becomes problematic. That means there is no lead way. You either answer them or you don't answer them. So you either meet the standard or you don't meet the standard. NENA's current standard is 90% of the calls will be answered in 10 seconds for a 24-hour period. A little bit more lenient. But with both of these, the problem is there is a set defined period that can occur at any given time, because we're looking at the busiest hour of a 24-hour period. We're looking at the busiest hour of a shift. You don't know when that busiest hour is going to occur. It could occur when you're staffed for it. It could occur at 2 in the morning when you have minimal staff on and you do not meet that standard because you get inundated. You could have a major accident on a freeway. Suddenly you have dispatchers cannot answer the calls. That throws your call standard off. So it's really trying to find something that's more consistent that we can adopt to all PSAPs. We did have an interesting conversation with a gentleman from the state of Washington. He was one of the PSAP managers, and he recanted to us that in Washington, every county has a different standard for call answering. They're allowed to set their own. They don't necessarily follow the NENA standard. So I found that quite interesting. I'm sure it becomes very dicey when something happens and they start asking questions why all the PSAPs aren't following the same standards. We also have talked to NENA, and they're considering a new call standard. If you look at their website right now, the call standard section is under review, and they're looking at the National Fire Protection Association's call standard, which is currently 95% of all calls will be answered in 15 seconds without a defined time period to it. So basically, on an average, you answer all your calls within 15 seconds, or 90%, 95% within 15 seconds. The office ran a little statistics for that, and we took out the time frames in this, because when you look at California's ability to meet our current published standard, very few PSAPs can do that. So when you look at our standard right now, 100% of all 911 calls within 10 seconds, 90% of California PSAPs don't meet that. And that's very restrictive, and I agree. It's just there's things that are going to occur that will not allow a PSAP to meet that standard. When we look at the NENA standard based, and this was based over an 18-month time frame, when you look at the NENA standard, 90% of all 911 calls will be answered within 10 seconds. 15% don't meet it, so we have an 85% success rate with the NENA standard when we look at over a time frame continuous. And then when we look at the National Fire Protection Association standard, which is 95% within 15 seconds, 91% of California PSAPs meet that standard. The question that came up is it too loose of a standard or is it an appropriate standard? And what is the standard we should be really shooting for? And that's kind of the target in the dark we're trying to hit right now. And that's what's kind of generating discussion from the advisory board is where should we be hitting? I mean, should we putting a standard that most PSAPs can meet based on historical data that we have right now, or should we really be pushing for a tighter standard and bringing these PSAPs in the line that aren't meeting the standard? Because when you do look at it, there's a number of PSAPs, they're just below the standard, but then you have a set few that are way down there. And I agree, those are the ones we really need to address. And I don't care which of these standards, they tend to fall below every standard when you run the reports. And those are the ones that we really need to take a look at, where they're down at 60 and 70% of the standard. And why aren't they meeting those? So I'll open this up to discussion from the board members at this time.
Is there a common, the ones that are way below, is there a common theme between what type of PSAP, small, large?
They vary. We have some large PSAPs, we have some small PSAPs, we have some medium-sized PSAP. When we do go out and talk to them, majority of the time it's staffing is the issue for not answering the calls.
So if I, from the board's standpoint here, you're looking for our recommendations then on how we should be looking at this and either coming to weigh in so that this will give you a set standard to place into the operations manual and to have the follow-on discussion on compliance and what does that mean when somebody fails to meet the standard?
Yeah, correct. I mean, the standard is always obviously the first thing. We would like to see something consistent that we expect the nation to go with so we can compare ourselves to other states and how they do. So obviously it's the NENA standard or the National Association or National Fire Protection Association, Prevention Association. And as you said, Mitch, the second part is how do you address that in a penalty-wise? I mean, there's a number of things that come up, you know, writing letters to them. We can bring the Attorney General in via the Warren Act if we need to. But when you have a PSAP that says, well, I can't afford staffing, which I know is a number of cases where they've told us that. How do you address those situations? We can cut their funding, but that doesn't necessarily resolve the problem. It could worsen
that's,
the problem.
And it's a good point, Bill, and I appreciate it. I kind of lean towards throwing out the anomalies in it. So I do like having some sort of annual average where you get a chance to evaluate a PSAP, really how they're doing on an annual basis. And for that standard, I think we should be setting a good threshold there. We have some other ones that you threw out there. So your question is, you know, is the fire the National Fire Standard, is that too loose? I don't know. I think that's not a bad standard that you mentioned it in 95%, 15 seconds. And, you know, looking at, some of the other ones, I think there's a right balance from it that everybody should be evaluated against and give them a target so that we can ensure that the public safety is being met.
Yeah.
Bill, does NENA or any state have a standard where they recommend a comm center staffing based on call volume that you could a PSAP that has this call volume, the recommended minimum employment staffing is X number of people?
I don't know if there's a standard for a number of people. When we do it, we base our funding on the number of positions needed to answer the call volume that PSAP.
So you have a formula base?
Yes.
On that?
Yes, and that is defined in the operations manual.
There's another program that APCO has called Project Retains, which does some specific calculations on what the staffing should be for a center based on a variety of factors, so.
And where I'm going with that is, as you know, trying to fight for your dollars to staff a center, if you can go in with a recommended staffing level, that usually helps people obtain staffing to properly staff their center.
Yeah, and I'll be honest, there's an expectation on our part that when we fund a center, and if our numbers come out and say you're funded at a five position and you need five positions, the onus now becomes on that PSAP to make sure there's five positions available to answer those calls, and we understand there's fluctuations, but that's on the PSAP to make sure they have the staffing in place to meet the peak hours or the busy hours, so they don't get caught in situations where they can't answer the calls, and then situations happen where it ends up in the paper because something happened due to that.
Yeah, I think speaking, I do sit on the technical committee for the National Fire Protection Association 1221 standard, and probably 10 years ago we changed it from a you have to have so many dispatchers to handle so many calls to a what they call a performance standard, which is 95% of the calls have to be answered in 15 seconds. So we don't tell the PSAP how many people they have to have. They just have to meet that standard, and it's certainly a lot more efficient because of the fluctuations in call volume and so on, and it makes the PSAP take a look at, you know, where their highest call volumes are so that they staff appropriately. So it's more of a performance standard, which I firmly support. And whether it's the NENA standard or the NFPA standard, obviously I tend towards the NFPA standard being on that committee, but I believe we need to go with a national standard. And certainly the standard that's in the operations manual today is very restrictive and needs to be loosened up a little bit for realism.
Good, because I think when you talk standards, I think it's a huge challenge, because I think the public expectation and our desire is to make sure that call gets answered as quickly as possible. But I think at the same time, there's the operational realities that we all face of trying to figure out, how do I staff a center so that we can answer those calls as quickly as possible? And then how do we measure it in a fair way so that when we're doing a really, really good job, we get credit for it, and we're not penalized that I had a big, ugly wreck on I-5 in the middle of the night. I answered the first call in 1 second, and then it was the 13th person who told me about the incident that was already going on that threw my stats off, and suddenly it makes it look like I'm not answering my calls efficiently, when in fact, we did a really good job. We got folks rolling, and as we're taking additional calls, it took a little bit longer, everybody was on their way. Yeah. As a matter of fact, we probably had people there, and we were still getting calls on it. And so how do you really measure that and quantify that to do it, and then how do you then use that to improve the performance of the system? Mm-hmm. Because I think when you look at, I cringe when it's like, well, take funding away from a PSAP that's not doing a good job, when in fact, that's probably the reason the PSAP's not doing a good job in the first place. And then how do we then look at the system holistically to really understand what is the staffing issues? Is it a technical issue? We just don't have enough trunks there so that we have the dispatcher sitting there, but we can't get the calls in. Or is it an issue of we have major spikes and how do we take those out of the formula? Or is it a routing that I'm answering a bunch of calls for someone else that should be answering them, and as a result, my numbers are off because I'm screening calls for other folks? Or is it, and we talked earlier about, all the misuse of the 911 system, but how do we really get back to that core reason of how do I answer that call so the public gets the emergency help they need, but also do it in a fair way and really, hit that performance and really do that in an accurate way so that we're not tweaking the numbers? Because as the old saying goes, statistics don't lie, but statisticians do. And how do we make it fair for our PSAPs and really make that a fair measure of how we're really doing, as opposed to, depending on the averages, you could average stuff out so it looks really good when in fact during a peak time, it's miserable.
Yeah.
And how do you make sure that we measure those in a fair way?
Yeah, and the two that we're really looking at, obviously the NENA standard and the Fire Protection Association standard. What we see eventually, if it does happen, is NENA will move away from that and go to the National Fire Protection Association standard, which, you know, obviously it helps California PSAPs out because they're able to meet that call standard quite easily, pretty well.
And I think that the NENA standard is, the at least anecdotally, the accepted standard for most PSAPs, and that I talk to not only in California but across the country, and the 90% within 10 seconds. So if NENA is going to adapt the NFPA standard, that's probably a fair way to do it. It's also averaged over a 24-hour period, or averaged.
Continuously.
As Chief Howland said, 100% at your peak hour is almost impossible to meet, and be it a small center or a large center. A large center can be inundated. A small center gets two calls, and they've got one person there. They're not going to meet the standard. So yeah. I think a fairer standard would be either the NENA standard or the NFPA, and hopefully those will be the same here in the near future.
Yeah. And I agree with what Charlie just said. I don't know how soon the NENA is going to move to the NFPA standard, but it seems like that is what is likely to happen. So I think our recommendation would probably be for the state to adopt that, the NFPA as the standard. And just in terms of, you know, talking about what can we do about that would leave, you know, 9% of California PSAPs that wouldn't meet that standard. And I think, as we've discovered in many other projects that we've all worked on together, there is a segment of PSAPs out there that just don't have perhaps the management structure in place where someone may not be looking at this information. Even you mentioned San Diego, which probably does have a management structure in place, but they were just in the news again highlighting how they've improved their call answer times in a pretty short turnaround. I don't think it was the raise that they gave, and I don't think they were able to hire and train people that quickly. It was just that they made it a focus. Through their management and supervision, they made it a focus of their center to try to meet these times. Mm-hmm. And so I would encourage the state to perhaps work with ECATS to find out if all PSAPs, or find out the PSAPs that maybe aren't receiving that daily report that gives us that snapshot. Mm-hmm. I think that would be a way. And then I think a follow-up letters from the state. I know that's putting the burden on you guys for someone to do that, but if that could be easily done, I think that's a great idea, because you're going to reach out to some PSAPs that probably are not even looking at this data. Right. And so, you know, you're going to hit a sheriff or a police chief or someone that's going to say, oh, holy cow, we're only answering 80% of our 911 calls.
Yeah, and that data is available to the PSAP.
I know it's available, but I would suggest that maybe some of that 9% is not even looking at
right.
it. And so if we proactively, you know, give them the data, that would probably help.
If I can summarize, just to make sure I've captured, it sounds like everybody here is in agreement that we need to adjust the current standard that's reflected in the ops manual, that it's not a fair standard to work from, and that it needs to be adjusted. And was that true, everybody? Okay. So then the second piece to that was which standard to employ. And it sounds like everybody's in agreement that it could be either one of them, leaning towards the NFPA standard. Did I hear that correctly from the group? I didn't want to belabor this as a long-term problem, and so I didn't think it needed to be vetted in a long-term study based off of what we have right now. So if that's the case, Bill, I think you have your marching orders now. Let's make the adjustment to the ops manual and the NFPA standard. And then it sounds as if that we probably need to have that as part of the quarterly report, then who's not meeting the standard, so that the board is fully aware. And Chris, your comment about letters to those that are not meeting the standard at that point in time, we've done that already. We've made some recommendations to some of those that have had problems, and we'll continue to do that, and then we can formalize that process. And then the board can think longer on what other actions you'd like, or what other things that you'd like to go with it hand in hand, now that we can start tracking that piece of it. Okay. Great. Well, thank you for that. Is there any other questions or comments? Did I not catch that? Okay. Completely. All right. Then moving on, Bill, if you can continue on then with your regular reports.
Okay. As always, you've got the primary handouts that are provided to you in your binder. The Setna account hasn't changed any. As we mentioned, we're hopeful that the hearing will generate some action as far as getting the Setna taken care of. The fund condition statement, it's given to you just as reference. It doesn't change but once a year, so I'm not going to address that. Wireless deployment status. If you notice, Oakland is still on there. We had the opportunity to go down and speak to one of the chiefs at Oakland and a dispatch supervisor, myself and Alicia from our office. It was a very productive meeting. We had the opportunity to explain to them that even though they're taking their calls via transfer right now, that they're really not saving anything because you're still taking the calls, whether they're coming directly to you or transferring. And we also explained to them the importance of why we don't want transfers. I mean, that's one of the things we've talked about over the past year. So out of that came is they're going to be working with our office now. We're going to be providing them with maps showing the call dispersion in the various cell sectors and working with them to get these cell sectors to transfer over to Oakland PD. So we've been providing them with maps, and Alicia with how many? So they have all the maps, so they're going to be going through those and working with us to start moving some of these sectors over to Oakland directly. So we're seeing progress in that, so we were happy with that. The next.
Bill, could I ask a couple questions? Yes. On deployment? First, thank you for working with Oakland. I appreciate that because we're screening their calls. And so
you're
we would like to get the calls to them, so because that'll impact our workload too. But I know that we have Oakland is on our list of restrictively deployed. I know that we have a number of agencies across the state that are not taking 100% of their calls. And with our reroute project, I know the goal is to get the calls to the agency that's supposed to get it. Mm-hmm. Is there a way we can track those agencies as far as who's actually not taking 100% of their calls so that we can then do some additional work on trying to move them forward? Because ultimately, I think, you look at the ripple effect of folks not taking calls, mm-hmm. and ultimately it's a delay for the public trying to get help with 911 if, in fact, they should be routed somewhere else. And then we do all the work for routing, and then we don't move the calls, so we really haven't accomplished anything there.
Yeah, I think, do we have a pretty good idea who's not taking their calls right now? So we have a good idea. We can provide that information next time on, because a lot of them are taking their calls, but like you said, maybe they're only taking 10% of the calls that should be taken, and we can bring that back up as a list of all the PSAPs that are doing that.
That'd be helpful to have. Thank you, Bill.
Okay. Okay, so moving forward, first item to update you on is text to 911. Last time at the board meeting, Cindy Freeman from San Bernardino County made a presentation. And since that time, Butte County recently deployed. They had their press conference a couple weeks ago. I had the honor of being there as Sheriff Honea announced that to the public. In addition, Los Angeles County is going to be deploying at 16 different PSAPs. They are not actively taking yet. They're in the process of deployment. They have not had the press conference or press release yet to announce that. But that does bring the total of PSAPs who will be taking text to 911 to 47 actively in California. So that's an improvement. We currently have 5 additional PSAPs that have filed with the FCC to start taking text, and an additional level 11 who are working with the text control centers to get set up for text. That's the predecessor to following the letter for the FCC. Our office is currently in communications with 98 additional PSAPs to take text. So when you look at all that right now, we have 161 PSAPs somewhere in the process of working with our office or the FCC to take text in California. So we're seeing a good progression right now. Obviously, we would like to increase this as much as possible. The goal, of course, is to get 100% of the PSAPs in California taking text. The method we're doing right now is we're really just, we're allowing PSAPs to, when they're ready, to come to us and say, okay, we're ready to start taking text. How do we do it? Then we go through the process of assisting them in filing with the FCC, working with the text control centers, bringing them up to speed on potential operational issues they may face by given them information we've received from PSAPs that have already gone through that process. The question that came up is, and it's to the board just real quickly, do you see other avenues we could be addressing to move PSAPs through this process a little bit quicker to take text as opposed to what we're the process we're currently doing? Anything else we could do to speed up the deployment of text and things we can do with the PSAPs?
I really think, and I've been looking at this quite extensively on for various projects. My impression is, and it's very similar to when we started working with the CHP to transfer the wireless 911 calls, it's a fear of volume. And I think Cindy's presentation last meeting was very enlightening, and I've shared that presentation with several agencies that it really isn't on the impact level that everybody is afraid of. And nobody knows what text is going to look like 10 years from now. I don't think anybody can predict that, and I don't think anybody in the 80s could have predicted what wireless 911 did or wireless cell phones. So I think really it's education. They need to understand what the impact is today, and if we can relieve some of that fear that it's going to add to the workload of the dispatch center. Dispatch managers, having been one, are very protective of their people. They don't want to overwork them. They don't want to add more toys to the toy chest, so to speak. But I've been very, having attended the APCO meeting or the APCO conference this year, been very encouraged that the CPE providers are now starting to provide the text functionality within their CPE, and we're not forced into a separate, web-based solution with another screen or another window on a screen. So I think education needs to happen to, with the CPE providers showing the dispatch managers the new solutions. And as these PSAPs come on board, gather statistics to show that it's not the workload monster that everybody's afraid of.
Yeah, and that's been really one of our main avenues of getting the word out. We always take advantage of any time we can attend a PSAP managers meeting where we have multiple PSAP managers there, or meetings like CalNENA and do presentations. And I think that's part of the reason, now that we are getting stats and information on text, because we didn't have that a few months ago until San Bernardino deployed. It was just, secondhand information we were getting. But now that we're actually seeing it, we're seeing, as Cindy mentioned, pointed out, we're 0.5% of your voice calls are text, very, very small. And from as Cindy pointed out, a lot of those are butt dials. That's a different issue we have to address, but they're there. So I think that's one of the things that's removing some of the barriers from a lot of the PSAPs, and we're seeing more and more PSAPs step up to work with our office and start the initial discussions with text. But definitely that's one area we need to maintain and continue working forward with is education of the PSAPs. And we are we're currently working with our PIO's office to get a web page up just on text to 911 so people can look across the state and see how California is doing with text. So we'll be showing call volumes and things like that.
Bill, I think what you've been doing between the office and Cindy and then what you're talking about is the right thing, and the momentum is building. Mm-hmm. You mentioned LA County, and we've got those 16 PSAPs that are going to deploy up in the San Gabriel Valley. I was at a meeting just last week where kind of the next group of us were talking about, as we move sort of in LA County, we're going to move southwest and more PSAPs will deploy.
Yeah.
There wasn't anyone in the meeting who didn't commit to doing so. A couple needed to get different levels of approval, but everyone was on board in the meeting that I attended. So yeah. I think we're going to see that across the state as as you know, the stats came in, and I think Cherie shared with us, it's the number of texts to 911 coming in that compared with the overall volume of 911 calls, it's, mm-hmm. you know, 0.1 or 0.2%. It's just
very, very small.
We're fortunate to have our Butte County member on the board who just rolled out and deployed. And I guess I'd ask if you had any comments or discussions, things that we could have done differently to help support you, kind of looking backwards, maybe.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity to make a comment. We are still very early in the process, having just gone live a short period of time ago. Our limited experience does support the assertion that the volume of text messages that we're receiving by 911 is relatively limited. However, I think it's important, even under that, given that the case, you're not introducing a new task in a vacuum. They still are answering 911 calls and business-related calls and non-emergency calls. And even if it's a small addition, it could be the addition that breaks the camel's back, so to speak. And when we talk about not being able to meet, 90% of our PSAPs aren't able to meet the standard that we currently have with regard to answering the calls, then I think we should make sure that adding something additional to them is done on the time frame that the PSAP and that the supervisors and agency leaders are comfortable with going forward. I agree with the education piece. I think that's important, but I also think that it's going to be important to have a very robust education piece for the community. We spent, as you know, press conference, I think I said, call first if you can, and then only text if it's an emergency, probably 50 times, and that was the central message, and we put that out on our social media and through our television affiliates and so forth and so on. Interestingly enough, as it is with everything like this, that message didn't get out. I was told about an individual who wanted to report a vandalism that had occurred 3 days prior and just felt it was more convenient to let us know about that via text 911. We ended up having to dedicate some resources to deal with that. So that's anecdotal, but I think we'll see more and more of that.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Thank you.
And thanks for that comment, Chris. That's it's encouraging news. That's it's nice to know that the community is embracing it and quickly, and I am hoping that momentum will continue. I'd love to see, I think our goal, obviously, as a board is to have every county employed and taking it and doing it as rapidly as possible. So. If somebody has an idea afterwards, something that they want us to pursue, an avenue via engagement or otherwise, we'll welcome that and we'll take that for it.
Okay, next topic was the wireless routing project that we started last year. We discussed this on a number of occasions, so I just wanted to update you on the numbers. Approved number of reroutes has increased to 4154. And that's working with some of the PSAPs that did not want to take the reroutes at first, but through discussion with them, they've chosen to accept. If you're looking at 191 are remaining, that's mainly Oakland. So as we see Oakland start to take their wireless calls, that number will decrease down. Probably the biggest number to look at right now is the number of sectors that have been rerouted via the carrier. Last time it was at 603, it's up to 1,355 right now, which is good, but it's not great. It's only 25% of the recommended reroutes we provided to the major carriers. And that's what we're struggling with right now is getting the carriers to put the emphasis on getting these reroutes done. I had the opportunity to call each of the carriers myself and talk to them, at least two of them. The other two responded to me via email. General consensus is they have a lot of other work going on, and this work kind of blends in with that. Many of them deploying LTE solutions. So this has to work into the rest of the schedule when they're doing this work. If you turn the page, you'll see the actual number of breakdown of requests per carrier and how each one of those carriers is doing. Some are doing better than others. Verizon's a little over halfway. Sprint's just about halfway. T-Mobile and AT&T seem to be the two carriers that are really struggling right now in getting this work done. We're continuing to, talk to them and emphasize that this has to be done. This is public safety. You know, this causes transfers and stuff like that that we don't want to see. Our concern now, obviously, is with the passage of 1564, we now have a continuous requirement to monitor this and to present these to the carriers. We can't see these build up. I mean, this can't be something and it sits and we come along with the next group reroutes and they still haven't finished out the first group. So we have to find a way to get the carriers on board as these come in to address these as quick as possible. And so we don't end up with a lot of reroutes that have not been addressed.
Bill, is there more work we need to do with the carriers? Because it seems like, you know, I know our staffs have been working really, really hard on identifying those reroutes. It's a lot of work for the county coordinators as well as all the PSAPs involved, mm-hmm. only to then get held up by waiting on carriers to get stuff done. And I know we've had some that have taken quite some time to get done.
Right.
How can the board assist your office in really emphasizing the importance and trying to move the carriers along and actually getting the task completed?
Yeah, that's a good question, is how can the board assist us? Because you and I have both sat in meetings with them and talked to them, and we keep pushing this information to it, but it doesn't seem to be getting to the place where it needs to be. So we're fighting this issue, and it's not going to go away. Obviously, it's now become in law now. So it's there, and we have to do it, but we have to make sure those things get done. And is how do we get? That's the million-dollar question. Is how do we get the carriers on board so as they come in, they get addressed very quickly, and get off the table.
Right.
That was my question. What teeth does the state or your office have in making them get it done within a certain period of time? Or are you toothless?
That's what we're looking at. That's what we're looking at right now, is what avenues we can actually take to get the carriers on board. Obviously, talking to them is the one thing, but it's not getting the results we really want to see. Is it a letter from our director to the carriers emphasizing that? Is it utilizing the CPUC, who has some regulation over the carriers, but maybe not necessarily in this area? But so it's finding that, like you said, it's finding the teeth to bring the carriers in line with us on where we want to see these reroutes go and get them completed.
So I think these numbers are, and I know it's not or folly, these numbers are disappointing, and I think it's on them to do it. Mm-hmm. And we identified this was a push to get this done quickly. We did it, and now things that we've 33% have been changed over in a year, essentially.
Yeah.
Would it be helpful to have the carriers come to our next board meeting and, or at least ask them to come? Maybe we'll just get the same, you know, reaction they did at a legislative hearing a couple of weeks ago where they will just tell us they're working on it.
You can always ask them. I mean, like you said, what the response is going to be, who knows? But, it's just what we're hearing is just they've got a lot of work to do. These are not the number one priority. So it's kind of blending in with the rest of the work. Some of the carriers are doing better than others. But part of the problem is, too, is we go to do the review of the cell sectors, if these aren't done yet, we can't look at these again, because we need to have a certain amount of data set sitting there for us to take and look at to make a reasonable decision on that. So as these things build up, it kind of is counterproductive, because now we have a lot of sectors we can't address because we just don't have the data set to make a reasonable analysis of. And that becomes problematic.
And I think, you know, if you to the hearing that we had a couple of weeks ago here in the state talking about SETNA funding, their trade representative, the Wireless Trade Association, their actual suggestion to the SETNA funding problem was just to use general fund money to fund 911, which is, you know, crazy. And I think we're getting to more of this. They're kind of directing what we do, and we're on their timeline. And it would sure be nice to be able to figure out a way to put some sanctions on them to do really what they should be doing.
I love your idea of inviting them to come join us at the board meeting, because I see them as one of our partners. And they're part of the team, and we've got to have them here and have the discussions and hopefully, you know, emphasize the importance of it, because ultimately it's the person who's trying to call 911 that ends up getting transferred, this delayed that we're trying to fix.
Yeah. Well, we can send the invitation out to the four individuals we've spoken to who are the representatives from the carriers on this project and ask them to come and talk to us. So I mean, there could be things I'm missing that, you know, they want to make sure that we understand what the problem is. And at least that point in time, we can talk about avenues to correct those.
Right. Because I think the other part is hearing from them is there ways that we can do better to help them so that as a team, we can actually improve the process. And whether it's how we order it, whether it's how we process it, whatever mm-hmm. the case may be, it seems like, you know, there's probably efficiencies on both sides. And to identify those, that would probably be really, really helpful on yeah. that. And then one other question I had is, I know that as we've tried to transition, we've had a couple agencies say they're going to accept calls and then put it on hold. Is it possible to quantify those on a report? Because I think that's going to skew our numbers as far as getting things completed. And I know it's going to impact us on future data and everything else, but to really give us the quantification of, okay, how many were agreed to that we're now on hold because that's almost like unapproved mm-hmm. sectors,
right.
So that we can kind of capture the whole world as far as the data goes.
Yeah, I think we have that information. Okay, we can put that down.
Super. I appreciate that.
Okay, and then the last item.
So just to recap, so we'll extend that invitation for the next meeting. I think it's a good idea. I think we should publicly recognize those ones that were 100% complete, the bottom three on the list, because quite frankly, they took it to heart and did it seriously for us. And then we'll engage some more. I know that the board should know that the director did send a letter. We did prepare a letter for him too and ask them for their continued support already that had gone out between the last meeting and this meeting just to say, we need your emphasis. You need to do this. We're already encouraging them. It's not as if we're not trying to move this along. And then we may need to figure out a different plan if we can't get a response. Bill, your comments, though, about the statistical sampling is absolutely true. So now we have legislation that asks us to go back and do annual assessments and routing. And if you haven't done the rerouting, you can't get a large enough statistical sample to effectively evaluate and figure out whether or not we have a need to reroute again. So we'll have to reapproach that one again with them, and we'll emphasize that with the carriers when we get a chance to communicate with them.
Yeah, because we want to see at least a minimum 6 months worth of data to be able to evaluate a sector. Okay, the last one is just an update on the next-gen 911 transition plan. Last time, Artie Porter from L.R. Kimball came out and made a presentation. Basically went over the whole transition plan itself, so I'm not going to go back over that again. Basically they've done the technology assessment. That report is with the 911 branch. It's being reviewed right now for comment and then response back to Kimball. They are currently working on the operational requirements and system design options, which kind of dovetails into the discussion we had this morning on the optimal PSAP architecture portion of it. So we'll be looking to see what their suggestions and recommendations are for California. That'll be quite interesting. And then, of course, once that's done, they'll be looking for at the implementation plan governance and funding models for California. So that's basically the update on the transition plan right now. And that's everything I have.
Are there any questions or comments? I know we hit a lot of them along the way. If there's anything, alibis? Hey, thank you, Bill. Appreciate the good report. And I want to thank you for your continued support. I'd like to move into the Long Range Planning Committee report.
Thank you, Mitch. The Long Range Planning Committee met yesterday afternoon and really had two primary topics of discussion. One was revising the call threshold as it exists in the operations manual for new PSAPs. That's in Chapter 3 of the operations manual, and the current call, as everybody's probably aware of, is 300. So as a minimum call volume per month to qualify as a new PSAP. And there was considerable discussion about that. Our original proposal was 800, and the thought being that 800 is the threshold for level 2 funding in the operations manual. But as the discussion progressed, there was additional There was a suggestion that we actually move it to 1,200, and that might be a better threshold for new PSAPs, 1,200 calls. And just to give you an idea of what that means per hour, 800 calls is about 1.1 911 calls per hour, and 1,200 calls is about 1.6. So not a huge call volume. That being said, I think in some smaller centers, one or two seat PSAPs, that really is an issue if you have a large incident, an accident, or a major medical issue or something like that, that one or two people can be tied up very easily. So it's not just the call volume, it's the impact on the center, and that's something that we have to think about. But I think that the LRPC wanted to come to the larger group and see what the thoughts were of the group on which of those two numbers would be more acceptable. I think we were leaning towards the 1,200, but we wanted to hear from the entire advisory board before making a recommendation.
Thanks, Charlie. I would just chime in that one of the conversations we had about 1,200 is, we know we don't want to have a whole bunch of new PSAPs, and really regionalization consolidation is a plan. And with 800, that would kind of open that door for more standalone PSAPs. And if we moved it to 1,200, it kind of gets us to start to look at how can we consolidate more, regionalize more, and share resources, and maybe improve services for some of these small one or two people PSAPs. So, that was kind of the theory of bouncing between the two numbers. It kind of supports the overall plan of the state and the direction of the state.
And I'll just, in terms of more numbers for you to help consider, I'll add these, because this helped me. Just wanted to give some perspective to the 800 and 1,200 thresholds of the current California PSAPs. The State 911 office shared with us that there are approximately 119 that would be under the 800 threshold, and then approximately 166 under the 1,200 threshold. So just to give you an idea of how many PSAPs are out there. But I agree. I think through our, we talked about this at our previous meetings, talked about it again for quite a while yesterday. Again, right now the proposal is only to make a change to the threshold that would impact new PSAP requests. And so I would support the 1,200 threshold.
Well, I think the recommendation is solid, and if there's not any other comment, at least at this time, we'll move forward that, and we'll take that forward back to the branch, and then that is a recommendation from the board, and we'll incorporate that into the operations manual.
Okay, thank you. The second topic of discussion was the long-range planning committee, and the advisory board had directed the working group to take a look at consolidation in a variety of areas. And we wanted to not limit the scope, but provide some direction. So when we went to the working group, we asked them to look at five issues involving consolidation. What are the critical components of consolidation? Is there more than one model for consolidation in the state? Are there incentives that would drive consolidation? And what are the major barriers to consolidation? And finally, we asked them to look at consolidation of PSAPs with a call volume of under 800 calls a month. And as the threshold is being raised to 12 for new PSAPs, we probably would ask them, probably raise that to 1,200 for the ongoing discussion. And Chuck Burdan and his group have done a great job in getting started on that process and come up with a lot of information. So I'm going to have Chuck review what he brought forward yesterday for the larger board.
Thank you, Charlie. In your packet, in your binder is the draft presentation that the work group has put together. And since we have several new members of the board, I'll do a little bit of background. The 911 work group was created a couple of years ago to basically be kind of the tactical team that actually goes and does a lot of the footwork on a lot of research projects that we put together here for the advisory board and the long-range planning committee. It's not, when the work group got together, we made a couple of assumptions and positions to work from. It's not our intent in this document to make policy recommendations, but to provide a background, facts, and statistics towards regionalization and consolidation. And the other critical aspect that we didn't want to do, but it's so easy, especially for those of us who have been parts of consolidations in the past, is not to look at the full range of components. This is looking at, we're going to try to focus on the 911 component only because that's our scope of work. The makeup of the work group, as specified by the advisory board when it was at its inception, was one advisory board member, which is myself, one representative from the 911 branch, which is Sophia Long, representative from the County Coordinator Task Force, which is Lori Souter, representative from the California State Sheriff's Association, which is Leanne Magoski, who's in the audience today, representative from the California Police Chiefs Association, which is Shelley McCarran from Anaheim. Then some at-large representatives, one representing large PSAPs, which is Cynthia Freeman from San Bernardino County, medium PSAPs, which is Lynn Bowler from the city of Elk Grove, small PSAPs, which is Greg Pascal from CSU Long Beach, and secondary PSAP representative, which is Don Wise from Verdugo Fire in Southern California. At our first meeting, the group also had the option and took the option to invite some subject matter experts to assist in the research. And we've invited Jamie Young, a former advisory board member and the director of the San Mateo County Communications Center, Ella Sotelo, who is the county coordinator for the County of Los Angeles, and Debbie Grady, who is the PSAP manager for the Sacramento Police Department, but more importantly, a fairly new transplant to California from Washington, where she was involved in several of the PSAP consolidations in that area. So with that group constituted, we have had, I think, three conference calls. As Charlie said, we had marching orders from the LRPC to look at critical components, models for consolidation, incentives, major barriers, and then finally the call volume threshold. But one of the first things that the group needed to do is come up with some definitions. The terms regionalization and consolidation are very generic and very broad, what I call the 100,000-foot level terms. We needed to have some more specifics so that when we're talking about incentives and barriers that we're talking about the same thing. So to that effect, we went to the FCC's Task Force on Optimal PSAP Architecture, which document is also in the board packet tonight or today, and adopted their definitions of what consolidated centers can look like or can be configured under. So we have, I believe it's six definitions in the report. Shared services PSAP, which is basically when all the some multiple PSAPs are brought together under one roof and may or may not share management and resources. A hybrid center, which may have, or a hybrid consolidation or hybrid model, where there's separate physical locations, but perhaps share a common call handling function, and maybe share other services such as radio, CAD, or other dispatch equipment. A centralized call-taking center where you have all your 911 calls go to a central facility, a central PSAP, and then the who do the immediate analysis and triage of calls and then transfer the call to the appropriate law enforcement or fire EMS dispatch center. Then there's a consolidation by discipline, and this, the best example of this is many of the fire departments in California have consolidated either countywide or regional into consolidated centers. The virtual consolidation, we talk about sharing infrastructure and that's it. So this is probably the model where we're talking about hosted solutions is a virtual model. And then finally, the last one is the definition from, I took the definition from the National Emergency Number Association of a consolidated PSAP, which is defined as a facility where one or more public safety agencies choose to operate as a single 911 entity. So it's very similar to a shared service or a hybrid. So we took those definitions as our basis. And what I asked the 911 work group since our last meeting and got direction from the Long Range Planning Committee is to come up with an outline. So what you see here is an outline of what we're going to be doing. So we're looking for direction from the LRPC and from the advisory board to make sure that we're going in the right direction and we're not taking a task or a direction that perhaps we shouldn't be. So we took a look at, you know, what are the critical components of a regionalization and consolidation? And this is where the discussion about other tools, if you will, are needed to function as a PSAP. We have to recognize the fact that a PSAP runs on a CAD system, they run on a 911 phone system, and they have a radio system. I mean, this is common to any PSAP. We have to recognize that when we talk about regionalization and consolidation, we also have to recognize the fact that it's the phone system that is funded by the state. You know, the state does not, with one exception, does not fund CAD systems or radio systems. Those are items that are funded by the PSAP themselves and have a factor when we start talking about, oh, well, you need to consolidate. It's not just the phone system. When we looked at, I looked at models for regionalization and consolidation. I mean, there are a lot of models out there, good ones and bad ones. But what we wanted to do is use models primarily from California because California has some uniqueness to it. And I think, you know, models that, successful models, especially from California, are important. And we need to look at models that are not just, you know, large consolidations or regionalizations. We need to look at the medium, the smalls, you know, the larges, the extra larges, and secondary PSAP models so that when we come up with a guide, if you will, if this is the end result of this research, that a PSAP manager can look at models that most closely represent or resemble their own organization or their own potential models or potential consolidations that they're looking at. So we've developed a database of elements so that we can ensure that agencies can look and say, okay, this is a consolidation, this is about the same number of call volume, this is, you know, number of seats in a PSAP, so that we're comparing apples to apples. Then looking at incentives, This one is going to be a tough one to look at. You know, what's the advantages of regionalizing or consolidating? You know, anything that's going to make it easier to migrate or to have incentive to regionalize, you know, cost factors, et cetera. We have to recognize the fact that there are a lot of barriers to regionalization and consolidation. You know, not just technology barriers, but also personnel barriers, unions, you know, pay scales, et cetera. And then we, you know, the last item in the paper is further research, and this is kind of the catch-all basket for us to put ideas down that will probably end up in one of the above solutions, but we didn't want to lose any ideas and brainstorming, so we put that in. We're also going to build a reference table so that when somebody comes back and says, well, where did you get this, you know, particular statistic, we can refer back to the original source of information. So at this point, this is the outline that the work group is going to work on. If there are any suggestions from the advisory board on, you know, look at this, look at that, we certainly are open to entertaining anything that we can do.
Thanks, Chuck. There were some, it seemed that there were some smaller consolidations that had already taken place. How are you thinking they could be included in the after action process as kind of lessons learned to share with things that went well and didn't well go well, so we can take advantage of that?
Exactly, and that's why when we start looking at models, you know, we want to look at the models that have already been taken, you know, been used, and we want to make sure that we look at not just, you know, the 15 or 20 PSAPs that all get together. We want to look at the you know, two small agencies that decide in a county, hey, well, let's get together and we'll have the same dispatch center. So we want to make sure we have all those models, and obviously the ones that are in place, and there are a lot of examples of regionalization and consolidation that are you know, in the area of 30 years old now that are successful. Sacramento Regional Fire EMS is a prime example right here in this a mile away from here. They've been a regional center since 1995 for the whole county. So we'll look at those kinds of models and see what made them successful and long lasting.
Chuck, I know we talked about a timeline for the completed report yesterday. Do you mind sharing that with the board?
Yes, our intent is to have a final draft of this available to the advisory board at their next meeting, which is in November. It'll be a draft. It won't be a final report, but it'll be a final draft for the board to then take and make any final adjustments.
And I think the one other issue we talked about, Chuck, was the cost-benefit analysis. If there is anything out there, is already truly saving money by consolidation, and I don't know that we really saw any empirical evidence about that. And even the FCC report was ambiguous about whether or not you save money through consolidation. You know, are the startup costs amortized over 15, 20 years? Do you actually save money? I mean, we think you do, but we don't really have solid studies to point at. So one of the things we talked about was maybe looking for some additional information on cost benefit of consolidating centers. So,
and that's a good example, Charlie, of looking at some of the centers that have been in place for a long time. You know, my personal experience in Alameda County of consolidating fire dispatch centers, it took 8 years and several consolidations going along till finally we had a consolidation. We added Livermore Pleasanton Fire to our dispatch center and finally reached that tipping point where the cost to run the dispatch center, adding another fire department did not impact the bottom line. And in fact, the agency started to see a cost savings. Yeah, so it took 8 years and multiple consolidations to see that.
I think the other factor that would be interesting to know is if there's any way to quantify the performance as far as consolidation goes. Does it actually speed up the process of handling calls for agencies? And, you know, is there an improvement in coordination as far as emergency response goes? Because I think we spend a lot of time talking about performance, you know, and our goal is how do we improve performance and to really understand what consolidation means for that performance.
But that's a good point. I will add that to the... Thank you.
Chuck, thank you very much. Group has done a great job identifying the issues, and we look forward to seeing the report in November. One other point of discussion that the LRPC had that I did not mention but should is that when we looked at new PSAPs, the LRPC recommended that PSAPs that do not meet the criteria for a new PSAP may not receive 911 calls. And what I think that what that means is if you're turned down by the state and turned down by appeal, self-funding your own PSAP is problematic for a number of reasons. It's problematic because there's no way to deduce if the standards are being met, if the technology is up to par, and if we cannot gauge your call volume through ECATS and a number of other issues. So that was a recommendation of the LRPC that be added into the operations manual. So we wanted to also bring that forward for the larger group to see if there was a consensus on that.
I will say that I agree with you. I think that's if you're operating outside, there's no way for anybody from the public to approach us or anywhere else that can say, am I getting the service that's necessary and enforce that? So, you know, self-funding just drives too much potential for problems. And I know it's going to be the anomaly that would do that, but I think we should make it definitive that it's not an acceptable method for it.
And just to add to Charlie's points there, in our discussion with the State 911 branch, we believe that's already spelled out in the Warren Act, but we just want to encourage the state to incorporate that into the operations manual, since that's where most agencies that are looking to start a PSAP are going to the ops manual, where it kind of spells out what is needed. So I think it's important to have a couple of sentences in there that make that clear.
Charlie, did the LRPC discuss the issue that was brought up at the last advisory board meeting about access to data from cell towers from PSAPs?
No, it was not an agenda item, but I think it probably should be added. I know we've had discussions about that. Is, you know, the transparency of if a call touches your center, or you should be able to see the data from start to finish. And I think that's something we've all agreed on. And I'm not sure that is the full capability exists right now in ECATS, or that it's been on, it's probably there, but has it been unlocked so that everybody can, that all the PSAPs can get that information as if they need it?
Well, that's where I'm a little frustrated, because I think we made it clear last meeting we couldn't discuss it at the advisory board meeting because it needed to be vetted out, and we put it on the agenda, I thought, last meeting to be discussed, and now we're going to go into three more months of having to discuss it in 3 months. So, I mean, to me, the request is very simple, that PSAPs that you just stated it, the technology aside, if the technology can do it, but I think the confusion is that there's some that believe that certain PSAPs don't have a right to see what other PSAPs see and vice versa. So I don't see if it's a problem right now for this advisory board to say, if you agree, to direct the state 911 office to make that happen. And if they come back and say the technology doesn't allow it, then that's one thing. But again, I don't want, we all have second jobs. I know it's like one more item we need to discuss, but to me, the request is fairly simple. And I'd ask the chair if this is an appropriate time to have this advisory board direct that to happen.
I don't know if it's, I guess a question I have right now is, I don't know if I have the necessary background piece for it, but I do agree that it needs to be discussed. So I thought when we left the previous meeting that the the question was, is when, if a PSAP is reaching to the county coordinator to facilitate that, they should be able to get the data they need to support whatever, you know, inquiries that they have to support themselves. And so I thought that that had been previously resolved, but it apparent, you know, it doesn't sound like that's the case.
Right. The county coordinator, I believe, can see the county-wide information. My request, because there's some level of county coordination involvement, some counties have really good ones, some counties, it's their third job, that I requested that a PSAP be allowed to see data that impacts their PSAP. So whether the call is originally routed to CHP or a neighboring jurisdiction, that they have the right or the ability to look at that, aside from the county coordinator.
And I don't know if we have the necessary information on that to even address that to us right now. Do we have that, Bill, to?
Yeah, we had an opportunity. Alicia went down and worked with Aegis because we wanted to get clarification exactly. And Alicia,
if you can kind of expand on that, because part of it has to do with us being able to provide a report for Dave can see to see what he needs, to information he'd like to see.
Yes, so I did have the opportunity to speak with David. I appreciate your time to clarify the request and exactly what's being requested, and which I did, and I brought the information back. What the desire is to, we can do some things today in the reports. We cannot do everything. In the reports today, if you touch a sector, which means you receive a call transferred to you, you have the ability to now see that sector because you had a hand in calls from that sector. So you have partial visibility today, which is not doing what it needs to do. The request is so that if you need to be able to see the entire tower around you. It does not exist today in the reporting system. We have all the information that we need in order to start that process. That's going to take some work in the reporting system. I can't just turn it on, unfortunately. And it's in the way that we build the reports. But yes, it can be done. Yes, we are moving towards that. There are other things that are taking priority in the current existing reports that we have that we have to finish, and then we can move down that path. So I do understand what you're asking for. We do have the information that we need, and we can start moving down that path. I think the greater discussion is how that gets presented to each PSAP in the reporting system. We don't necessarily have all the capabilities today, so when we go to write those capabilities and create them, we need to make sure that we're doing it in the right fashion. You would think that it's as simple as just, you know, give that person permission. The way our system is built, it's a very comprehensive system that allows you to do many things, not just wireless review. So if we add permissions, simply add permissions, we would be adding permissions to do lots of other things inside that other agency's data, which I don't think is the intent. We're focusing in on the wireless routing only with this request. So I want to make sure that we are conscientious of that and don't just open the system up to everybody, which is not the intent.
Well, and I thank you, and I think for your time coming down there. I don't want to make this a Dave report by any means or my project. I'm simply bringing it up because I've talked to some colleagues, and we always talk about transparency, and we talked about that a lot today. And to me, that's transparency to make sure that if you have PSAP A that doesn't really care, they don't analyze things, and they just go on. If they have control over that tower, PSAP B, who's really into this and may want to have a lot of knowledge, won't get it unless PSAP A shares it with them or does the analysis. So that's my only point. And maybe, I know we're at the end of our day here, but if we could agendize this for the LRPC next meeting, that maybe the state office could come back with some information. It could be discussed there, and I'd be glad to participate in that if needed. And then next advisory board meeting, we can kind of conclude that. Again, I don't think it should require too much time. Maybe it's more of a technology issue. But
yeah, I think we'll put it on there. And Charlie, if you can do that, I don't have an issue with that at all. I think it would be worthwhile discussion. It sounds like there's more to it, though. So you're absolutely right. So there's a technology piece. There's a policy piece, and then there's a leadership piece, you know, and how do we, you know, put that cooperation together, and then what actions do we need to do from the 911 branch to help facilitate that, and or from the board, kind of hitting all of those topics. So I'm certainly comfortable going through that, and let's kind of dive into this a little bit and make sure that we're serving the public good.
And then could I just piggyback on Dave's, because I think it's great to get it to the committee to look at and really define what we need to get everybody the data that we need so we can make wise decisions. And then I was going to make a request that's similar from the standpoint. We have a new bill that's requiring us to ongoing evaluate things, and it would be helpful to probably have an update as far as where we are on automating and new reports. And I know they were working on some mapping things and other things to make our jobs easier as we move forward. So it would probably be valuable to have an update of what new things are being worked on and what are the status of those things as we look at implementing the new law and making sure that, you know, as we go forward, the process gets easier and that we can reduce the number of manual hours spent and, you know, automate a lot of those things.
Excellent. Well, thank you. Any parting items before we adjourn off the next item?
No, thanks for your time, and we'll take on that next issue. It sounds like ECATS and the state are working towards a solution, and there's maybe some administrative issues, but if Alicia and maybe Chief Wilson, if you wanted to be there for the LRPC in November, that would help. So thanks.
Well, I on behalf of the board, I just want to say thank you, Charlie and Chuck. You guys are taking doing some yeoman's work, and Chris and everybody's been participating to jump on this. It's hard stuff, and every time we tackle something, there's second and third order ramifications to each of these items, and so I appreciate the diligence that you're performing and the leadership that you're serving there. Okay, moving on. Next item for us is the County Coordinator Task Force Report, and looking forward to hearing that from Ms. Kessler.
Good afternoon. This will be short. We don't have a lot going on. We did finish the education and information fact sheet for the public safety heads. It's now complete. I believe you have it and are ready to distribute that.
It was very nice, and thank you.
Thank you. As Chuck mentioned earlier, we have two County Coordinator Task Force members helping, one as the core member and one of the subject matter experts on the PSAP work group that supports the LRPC that's currently working on the Consolidation Regionalization Benefit Report. And we also continue to mentor and support county coordinators and hold monthly county coordinator conference calls to keep connected with all the county coordinators. And those are our tasks.
Thank you. In light of the discussion that Chief Wilson was just bringing up, we may need your participation on that next LRPC as well, because that cooperation and how information sharing is going to be a critical piece within the county coordinator side of the household. So look forward to having your participation there as well.
Thank you.
Board, is there any questions for the? Okay, sorry. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Kessler. Okay, we had at this time any other future agenda items that we wish to have surfaced for the upcoming meeting. Okay, hearing nothing, we'll move into public comment. Just as a reminder, it's limited to 3 minutes per person or organization, and those providing public comment, you're certainly eligible to submit any supplement to your testimony with written statements that can be made as part of the official record.
Good morning. My name is Darrell Whitmer with Frontier Communications. I'm sorry, I have a wee bit of a cold. Just wanted to take a quick minute to introduce Frontier Communications for those of you who don't know us. On 1201 April 1st, we took over the wireline properties, acquired the wireline properties from Verizon. That means we got responsibility for 911. We have responsibility for the Alley database, all of the network, and thanks to the fact that we were able to get the MPA assigned to us through a novation agreement. We can sell CPE now in the state of California. So we are out working with the PSAPs that were Verizon PSAPs plus the legacy PSAPs. With me today are Ron Broom, who is our service manager, and Kim Olliman is a 911 specialist. We have two other specialists in the state of California who are responsible for working directly with the PSAPs, providing them help and support with any issues that we have. We are fully committed to providing the highest level of 911 services in the state of California. If you would like a more official presentation from us as to the resources that we have and what we're providing in the state of California, please feel free to let us know, and we will set up time on the agenda to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Daryl. I know I speak for all of us. It's great to have you here and with us, and I think you saw some of the early agenda items that we had on the wireless rerouting projects, and we certainly appreciate your support in moving that forward and that initiative there, and it'll be an opportunity probably at the next board meeting to have a greater discussion. So
we look forward to it, sir. It's been 4 years since I presented to you folks, so
fantastic.
Appreciate the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that for public comment?
I actually have a quick public comment. It's my understanding that this is Bill Anderson's last 911 advisory board meeting, so I just wanted to congratulate Bill on his pending retirement, and on behalf of the board and the PSAP community, thank him for all of his great work over the past 3 years. It's been a pleasure working with Bill. He came over from the radio side, understands the issues, very easy to work with. You know, we've gone through some difficult times in transitioning, but the OES model has been great, and I just wanted to thank Bill publicly for all he's done over the past 3 years and wish him all the best in retirement. So
thank you, Charlie. It's been a pleasure working with the board for the whole of these last 3 years.
And I'd just like to echo those same comments. Thank you, Bill. We've worked closely on 911. You worked years for on the radio side for us, and it's always been a pleasure working with you, Bill. And I'll tell you, you're leaving some big shoes for whoever's following in your footsteps. But again, we're probably a little jealous because you're doing the retirement thing and we're not. Congratulations on that, well earned, and thank you for all you've contributed to public safety, both on the 911 side and the radio side.
Thank you, Chief. Appreciate it.
I would just like to say, Bill, I would like to make a motion to the board that we accept his retirement, deny it, and resubmit in 24 months. again, Bill, thank you. Well,
I think there's a unanimous aye at that motion. I just don't know if I can compel him.
Congratulations and thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Well, outstanding. Well, listen, thank you again, and I know it goes, we want to say thank you, Bill, for all of your hard work for all of us. Before we adjourn, is there any other announcements that we need to have shared with the board? Okay, if there's no further business and no objection, we'll be adjourned, and I appreciate everybody's time today, and thank you so much, and please be safe on your way home. This concludes the meeting.